I'm Alan Murray with the Wall Street Journal. We have welcome to the Council on Foreign Relations. I just got back a couple weeks ago from the World Economic Forum in Davos, and my experience over the years is every year there's sort of one topic that captures people's imagination and becomes the issue that is most talked about each year. In the 90s, it was technology. From 2001 to 2006, it tended to focus on U.S. foreign policy, militarism, interventionism. Last year, private equity was the hot topic of conversation, not quite so hot this year. But this year, it was sovereign wealth funds. A great deal of attention, a great deal of a discussion. These giant pools of government-controlled capital now approaching $3 trillion by at least one estimate, headed towards something more like $12 trillion in the not-too-distant future. The central question, I think, in this controversy, U.S. officials, IMF officials, spent decades going around the world preaching the virtues of privatization, of getting enterprise out of the hands of government. Now we have this huge trend of sovereign wealth funds buying large stakes in private businesses. Is it something that we should be worried about?
You should worry about it in the sense that it indicates that the world is changing very quickly, that wealth has shifted, and that the system that we have right now is not well suited to deal with these new flows. You shouldn't worry about it because it is recapitalizing the sectors that need most capital right now. I noted earlier, just think what the U.S. financial sector would look like today if you hadn't had $69 billion of pure capital flow into it over the last 7 months from sovereign wealth funds. It would be a very different outlook for the U.S. economy. It would be a very different outlook for the global economy. So I think the key issue is not just the sovereign wealth funds. It is that this is part of a much larger realignment of the global economy. And the infrastructure, be it in the public sector or be it in the private sector, is just catching up today to the realities that have already occurred.
Elias Garros is Citigroup. Where do you see the status of the dollar as a reserve currency for these funds? And do you see a risk of an unwieldy exit from the dollar spurred on by one of them?
And we are on the record.
I'm always on the record with regards to the dollar. We think that the adjustment process that's happened since the summer has been encouraging and orderly with regards to the depreciation of the dollar. The dollar has depreciated more than 20%, as you know, since 2002. And this happened. It's happened in a context of falling long-term interest rates in the U.S. So that's very good news. We still think the dollar is somewhat overvalued, meaning over a five-year horizon, which is the position, the outlook we have. We think that it will tend to depreciate in order to bring the current account closer to what we regard as a sustainable level. So that's the good news. The less good news is this adjustment process has been asymmetric. And again, I'm going back to the flows. You see, it's all about the flows to us. The stocks are important. We discuss them. It's an outcome of the flows. And the problem is that there are certain countries that have relatively inflexible exchange rates that have not, whose exchange rates have not moved in the direction we would regard as being towards that would sustain the current accounts at a reasonable level. And I'm talking about the lack of appreciation in certain countries. So, for example, we continue to regard China's renminbi as substantially or considerably undervalued. So over a five-year period, we think it should be appreciating in real effective terms to bring China's current account surplus down considerably. Now, that part of the process has not yet happened. The Chinese authorities are trying to make steps in this direction. We're encouraging them. Other people are encouraging them. It's not a zero-sum game at all. It's a very important process for sustaining global growth. I think that's the context in which you should. It's about exchange rate adjustments. I think the sovereign wealth funds in that context are, as Mohamed has emphasized, long-term players. They're long-term players who want to have diversified global portfolios. And I think that the chances, that there are serious financial risks out there, which we're talking about very explicitly, and which you saw, for example, reflected in the G7 communique. Those risks are mostly about highly leveraged institutions and the way in which risk is managed or not managed. That's not about sovereign wealth funds. Sovereign wealth funds have played a key stabilizing role in the past 6 months with regard to recapitalizing the bank system, and we should recognize that.
But, Simon, just to follow up on that for a second, putting the petrodollar funds aside, are sovereign wealth funds to some degree a creation of currency manipulation, in your view?
I think I don't like this, there are these kinds of funds or that kind of funds. I think we put them all together. You know, we have an open global trading system that has some very well-specified rules. The rules are always being adjusted, both at the global level and at the national level. That's fine. I think countries have come together and traded on a fair basis, subject to these rules. There are processes for appealing this particular kind of export or that kind of import restriction, as you know. And I think that in that context, it's important that there be sufficient exchange rate flexibility. Now, some countries find it easier to have exchange rate flexibility because of the nature of their economies. Some countries find it a little bit harder. We at the IMF have been encouraging very publicly certain countries to encourage, in this context, an appreciation, for example, of the Chinese renminbi. But it's not just about the Chinese currency. We also think that the yen, for example, is undervalued, meaning that we think it should be appreciating over the medium term towards a sustainable value. It's also about other currencies that have drifted away from what we regard as being sustainable, or you might want to call it equilibrium values. So I think that's what it's about. It's about allowing exchange rates to adjust, and it's about figuring out how to do that in context where not all economies are as flexible as that of the United States.
Herbert Levin, putting aside the Asian countries with surpluses for different reasons and discussing only Russia and the petroleum gas exporting countries, they have used these exports, cutting them down or unilaterally raising the prices, canceling contracts, when they had political aims against other Europeans, against the Americans, against the Israelis. Why would one expect them to refrain from using the weapon of their investments, their holdings into sovereign wealth funds, when they have not refrained from using their position as energy exporters in the past?
Well, I think, first of all, Russia is in a very different situation than the Gulf states and the Saudis. Certainly you can go back to the 67 war, which was a long time ago, and look at the political use of that. But that hasn't happened since. And it's very unlikely to happen now, because they know that if it did, it would cause a massive political reaction. They would be barred, basically, from investing in the U.S. It would be against their own interest. And as they're trying to integrate into the world economy, I mean, the Saudis now, you know, are part of the WTO process. They have their own, they're subject to the WTO rules. They don't want to be seen, nor do any of the Gulf states, as bad actors. They are long-term investors. I mean, again, one example which caused no political current at all in the United States was just a few months ago. I mentioned the GE plastics sale, the plastics division of GE, to SABIC, which is 70% owned by the Saudi government. Didn't cause a ripple. It's a commodity, has no national security implication. The Saudis are not going to somehow roll that asset up and take it to Saudi Arabia. It's going to stay in the United States. It was an undervalued asset for GE. So I really don't worry about the politicization of the Gulf funds. I think Russia's a very different situation. It's in a position where perhaps Saudi Arabia was in 1967, trying to use its petrodollars to muscle politically in a variety of countries. And there is a legitimate concern. Even the UK, which is perhaps the single most open market for foreign investment, had concerns when Gazprom was talking about acquiring certain natural gas and pipeline assets in the UK for just that reason. But in terms of the Gulf and the Saudis, I really think that is not a significant concern at all.